This should work. Thanks for this really kind introduction. It's too flattering, and I can only disappoint you in my talk, but I'll do my best anyway. I'd like to talk about what research institutes can do to foster research integrity. I won't say all about it, but I'll say some things about it at least. And I'll be overlapping not that much with the first presentation by Daniela Fanelli, but I'll make a few links along the way because there are some links. When I was reflecting on this talk, I realized that in the last decade I've been involved in research integrity, I've seen a kind of evolution, at least I believe I've seen a kind of evolution. When I started off, it was still very much about FFP only, the capital sins, fabrication, falsification, and plagiarism. And the idea was that these should be detected, diagnosed, investigated, and sanctioned. And then it became increasingly clear that that is not maybe the most important problem, because there is a lot of sloppiness in research as well. We are going to coin that as questionable research practices. And that means that because they are so common, so prevalent, so frequent, that they might be more influential on the aggregate level. And then we sat together and say, well, prevention of questionable research practices is a really important thing to do, although we should never stop detecting the culprits and the rotten apples doing the FFP. But there is also something going on in the aggregates, and we should cure that as well. And then the last few years, the emphasis shifted again a little bit, I believe, to responsible research practices that used to be called responsible conduct of research. And these are the positive behaviors we want to see in researchers, and we're trying to sort out how to stimulate them. And the idea is that not all of them, but many have to do with transparency, and transparency has a lot of to do with the modern things of open science. And I agree with Daniela Fanelli that open science is not a magical bullet, it's not a miracle cure. There are side effects, and we need to reflect on these as well. But they do many good things starting open methods, that is registration and pre-registration, open codes, explaining how you analyze your data in detail, and upload that before you start looking at your data, of course. After data open, a lot of side effects and difficulties here as well. And I also agree with Daniela that open access, that is nice to have. It's not essential, it's not need to have, it's not essential for transparency. It's important for other things. And then also in the same decade, we had this growing awareness of the replication crisis. And that is the understanding that in many fields, when you try to replicate a study, roughly in 10 up to 40-50%, you get the same answers, the same findings, the same results, the same conclusions in research. And also from that angle, there came a strong demand for more transparency, because then you could replicate studies, and for open science, because you need these three first things to be able to replicate a study and to look whether you get the same answer. So these things go together, and I talk on the aggregates in the rest of my talk. I'll show you some data. These are rather new data. They're only preprinted. That's my first warning. Not yet peer-reviewed, not yet published, only pre-printed. And by the way, below my slides are all the references also of these two preprints. And I asked the organizers of this meeting to make them available in one way or the other, preferably on the platform or on the NRO website. So when you're interested, you can have a look at it. This was a survey among Dutch researchers. And it has been conducted about a year ago. And the idea was to look in the stuff we saw on this slide and also look at the stuff which might be the drivers of these phenomena of bad and good behaviors and open science practices. And these are some results we found. Again, I refer you to the preprints to look in the methodology and the full results, but this is only a selection. We asked our participants about questionable research practices on a 7-point scale. And the reference was the last 3 years, and the 7-point scale ranged from 1, never, up to 7, and that is always. And we lumped together for the preferences 5, 6, and 7, so that's the upper end of the scale, so let's say frequent. So our respondents admitted to frequent, not submitting or resubmitting a negative publication, which is in essence publication bias. 70% said, well, we not always mention all important flaws of and limitations in our publications. 50% admitted to not supervising and mentoring their junior co-worker, like PhD students, sufficiently. A lack of equipment, skills, and expertise was admitted by about 50%, and also a little bit less than 50%. People said that they took not completely adequate notes of the research process. When you lump that together, remember we ask about 11 questionable research practices, and we say, now what is the prevalence of having at least one of these 11, a score 5, 6, or 7, then we have about half of the respondents. And this shows what I said before, that questionable research practices might be rather prevalent. Although it is what it is, so you have to look at the 10 items to know what exactly this 50% refers to. We also asked about fabrication and falsification, sensitive questions. We had some fancy methodology about it. That's only yes or no answers were possible. And a bit amazingly, maybe 4%, more than 4% admitted to having fabricated data during the last 3 years, and another 4% admitted to falsifying data the last 3 years. That is a bit higher than what is in the, I believe, 42 surveys up to date that also looked at this. The first 21 were summarized in the really excellent review by Daniele Finelli a number of years ago. And last year, or earlier this year, I should say, there was another review that takes them together, all 42. So we are in the upper range, but not out of limits. We also looked at the bright side of things, the responsible research practices, and there we saw that disclosure of funding and non-financial conflict of interest, a point that Daniele emphasized as well in his talk, almost all respondents said that they do that frequently. They 3/4 said that they followed FAIR principles frequently, a little bit less open access publication rather frequently, disclosure of code syntaxes and data, about half of them, and a bit more than 40% admitted to registration or pre-registration. So this is not complete. Here is some room for improvement, and this is almost perfect. That is, of course, if our survey led to valid answers. And one may wonder, why do some researchers not completely behave responsible? And there are many answers to that, and Daniele Finelli also alluded to some of them. I keep it simple and say, well, the reason is that they have a dilemma. There have many dilemmas, but a really important dilemma is that what is good for validity of research, for truth finding, so to say, and for trust in research is not always good for your career. Cutting corners helps to get some more spectacular results, to get in higher impact publications, to have to do less work. So it might bring you further along the road in your career while it's not exactly good for science. And the problem that scientists are struggling with are problems like this. They have to do with the mental compass in their head. That is important. They have a mental compass in their head. And it's driven by the virtuousness of that individual, whether they subscribe to the Mertonian norms that have been outlined during the first presentation, so elegantly, for instance. But there is also an influence from what they see around her, the culture, the climate in the lab, in the research group. We should realize that humans are social animals, and we tend to imitate what we see around us. When you see everyone around you cutting the same corner, you start cutting that corner yourself as well, no matter what you think about. At least most people will do that. And then there is the thing of the incentives. We know by now that it's probably not a good idea to only count publications, citations, and numbers of monetary units you get in grants, but you should do it a little bit more elegantly, because these incentives, the bean counting incentives, so to say, might be perverse incentives. And I allude to that later on in my talk as well again. Back to our survey, we looked at potential drivers of behavior of researchers, questionable research practices, FFP, research misconduct, and also the responsible research practices. And please remember, this was cross-sectional, so I cannot interpret in a causal way. It's only suggestive at most. But what we saw is rather interesting. The arrows indicate red is in the wrong direction and green is in the right direction, and the magnitude, the thickness of the arrow, so to say, indicates the effect size. And again, I have to refer you back to the preprints to show what all these arrows exactly mean and how we measured these explanatory factors. Interesting to note is that the likelihood of detection by reviewers, detection of research misconduct specifically, lowered was associated with a lower fabrication and falsification score. So the likelihood of being detected seems to matter. That's the suggestion. Publication pressure, which we measured with an instrument we have been publishing about before, higher publication pressure was associated with a higher prevalence of questionable research practices and lower prevalence of responsible research practices. And that is bad, of course, as well, because you want responsible research practices. Scientific norms, basically the Mertonian norms, adherence to that, at least self-reported. When that was the instance, it was associated with a lower questionable research practices. It also lowered research misconduct, which is okay, of course. I should say here that not adherence to the norm is associated with less. This should be a green arrow. Let me put it that way. I apologize for this misunderstanding. So scientific norms help as well. And I leave out the other on the slide. You can look at them yourself and again, look at the preprint if you want. I now want to allude to a project funded by the European Commission. And not only because Dorian is the next speaker, although he was rather instrumental in having all these grants available in Europe, this consortium, the Software AI Consortium, a huge consortium, we tried to draw together all the advice we could get for research institutions, how they could foster research integrity. Most of you might have seen this paper. I just allude to it again. And in this paper, as you might know, we allude to this. These are the 9 walks, so to say, the 9 topics, how we could improve research environment from the research institutional perspective. I'll only briefly talk about the first two, but the others are explained in the article, of course, that's obvious, but also on the website of the Software AI project, you see a toolbox. It's still emerging, but it's already rather well filled and interesting, an emerging toolbox, providing you tools how you can do these things when you're interested in having working ethics structures, good investigations to investigate breaches, and how to handle the declaration of interest, for instance. You can find tools in that box. So please have a look if you're interested there. One of the topics I'd like to emphasize in this talk is culture and climate. I said it already. It's possibly the most important influence on behavior of researchers, for the good or for the bad, in the responsible or the less responsible, or even research misconduct direction. What you see here is the cover of a report published last year by the Wellcome Trust. It is a really interesting survey done in the UK, rather large numbers, qualitative research, survey research, all of them together in a really interesting report on what the perception of researchers themselves is about the culture they're working in. We did a similar study in Amsterdam, which is where I'm based, among the academic institutions there. We have there two universities and one university hospital. And we had the privilege to be able to survey these people, to do focus group interviews and some other types of data collection in the research integrity culture. These are two publications of this project. There are a few more. And again, when you look at the PDF of my presentation, you can find all the other references. And this all together emphasized, yes, research culture, research climate is really important. And also the fact that there is so much diversity also within research institutes, between faculties, between departments, between disciplines, that suggests that there is something that can be done about it. It's not a trait of the research institutions of the university as a whole. It's a trait at a lower level. And perhaps we all know departments that function wonderful and have such a good culture fostering research integrity. And in the same institutions, you also have departments that function really badly and need to be repaired. So there is then room for improvement within the institution. This is a similar study from the UK again, a group of universities that believe that they are fantastic themselves. They lumped together in the so-called Russell Group. They studied research integrity and research culture as well. What is interesting that here they give some really practical advice, they give some case studies, and they also provide a toolkit how to work on a better culture of research locally. I can recommend these reports quite strongly as well. What I also discovered over the last years is that the early career researchers, the PhDs, the postdocs, can have an enormous, wonderful influence on change. They have less vested interest. They're slightly more idealistic than senior investigators, and they can be active and want to improve matters. And sometimes they do perfectly well, although I agree with Daniele that all that's coming from a minority is not by that version true and excellent, but we should really listen to the young investigators and give them the opportunities. And one nice initiative I'd like to mention is the reproducibility initiative, that they're supposed to drink tea, although that happened virtually over the last 2 years, of course. That is a kind of journal club, and it's well structured. It's popping up in many universities, multiple groups per university, and it fosters critical thinking and revisiting your own norms, your own behavior among young scientists. And it seems to work quite well for more reproducibility, but also for research integrity. In the Netherlands, we have open science communities. It's now spreading outside the borders, I believe, as well. You see it in many countries. And these open science communities, they Well, the dual aim is to learn how to do open science practices, which is not always easy and sometimes time consuming and complex and confusing as well, and also to reflect on what they bring and what they bring not. So they seem to be open to the side effects as well. And finally, I'd like to mention the reproducibility networks. It started in the UK. They have now an enormous grant of 8 million plus pounds, I believe, they got recently. And in many countries, they're now starting off reproducibility networks as well. We are working in it in the Netherlands as well, but all these countries were there before us. You cannot have missed the criticism against counting publications and citations, specifically the San Francisco Declaration is doing a lot of good thing. They also got a big grant recently and they're doing wonderful stuff currently. It is important, assessment of researchers. You see it in grant application. You do it for fulfilling vacancy. It's important for promotion decision, tenure decisions, and allocating awards. So this is a big deal. And it's an incentive. The reward criteria are strong incentives. And the problem is not that they don't work, these incentives. The problem is that they work so well. They do have the intended effects. When you start counting publications and citations, you get more. That has been proven in research repeatedly. But the problem is, and there is evidence for that as well, although less so, is that there are also strong unintended effects, like you have a focus then on quantity, not on quality anymore. You get more plagiarism in countries where they award the number of publications strongly, especially also use them for as parameter in the salary of the individual researchers. You get much more plagiarism and duplicate publication. You get this salami slicing, also mentioned already earlier this morning, gift authorship, use of predatory open access journals because they are so flexible in accepting your paper. You see citation cartels, fake peer reviewers, that has been mentioned not yet today, but the idea is that you just suggest a reviewer, open an email address that is fueling in your mailbox, and then you write your own peer reviews, and that can be wonderful, and your paper gets accepted. It makes the richer, so to say, the Mathieu effect, leading to less equity, because when you are successful, you attract more success, first and foremost by getting more grants. And people tend to shy away from the time-consuming responsible research practices. And yes, when the incentives are simple, they will be gamed because the stakes are so high. As a community of research integrity aficionados, we convene every few years in the World Conference on Research Conference, as you know, like we have now started today, the European Conference on Research Integrity. And last time we convened in Hong Kong, then it was still possible, we wrote the Hong Kong Principles. And the Hong Kong Principles are saying, what should you do when you're a judge researcher? Well, of course, count responsible research practices, reward that, complete reporting, open science modalities, a broad range, including peer review and mentoring. Now, that paper and the DORA, we are now collaborating quite closely. So the movement is going on, and you see in many universities, you see things happening. In the Netherlands, they joined efforts in the Room for Everyone's Talent program, but you see that in many countries. I'd like to allude to this preprint because it is another preprint. I'm serving you preprints today because they're new. This is a narrative review of many other things you can do once you want to improve assessment of researcher assessment, with a lot of practical advice as well. So I recommend this publication as well, although you can see I have a small conflict of interest here. What is important as well, and the rector in his opening speech mentioned that as well, is that we train our supervisors. We piloted in Amsterdam a course, Superb Supervision, that is combining the so-called soft skills, how to give feedback, how to be constructive to your PhD students, for instance. We combine these soft skills with the open science skills, because many of the supervisors had no clue how to pre-register a study and to publish their data protocols and the data files. And that is what they're supposed to learn, their new students nowadays. So the Superb Supervision we did, we're now working on a paper of that pilot study. The perceived effect of the participants was huge. It's now part of what we offer in Amsterdam to both the junior and the senior supervisors, but we still haven't studied the efficacy, although we believe it's a really good idea to train supervisors and organize also their contacts and exchanging experiences, because supervision and intervention is of course important. I'd like to end with a plea to more research on research integrity, like this picture is suggesting. And the good news that this is happening already. We are quite privileged in Europe, I believe, by the fact that the European Commission, I mentioned that before, is offering a lot of grants in our fields. The Horizon 2020 had this wonderful SWAFS program, Science Wizard for Society, and now Horizon Europe has the WIDERA program, and I'm sure that Dorian will talk more about it. That has been echoed in my country. We have a program by the Medical Health Council. It is translated roughly, that focuses on fostering responsible research practices. And we also have a program on replication studies. I'm chairing this one, so a conflict of interest again. Both programs are small. The money has gone, so we are now lobbying for new rounds of these programs, and we might be successful in that. But wonderful things will happen in European consortium over the next few years again. So finally, on time, I believe, I'd like to again invite you for the 7th World Conference in Cape Town. It will be end of May, be early June next year. We'll do it hybrid with as many people on the site as possible. And it's looking good now, but you never know COVID-wise. If not, we go completely virtual. So there will be a conference. And please, please, please submit your abstracts before the deadline of 15 October. We really anticipate another wonderful conference, as you say, because this is a wonderful as well. Having said that, I'd like to stop sharing my screen and give the floor to the chair again. Thank you.